Dear students, in this exercise we are given with six parts A to F. One by one I'll explain all the parts. Let's concentrate first on part A, where it is saying a vector needs three quantities for its specifications, and name the three independent quantities conventionally used to specify the Earth's magnetic field. When we talk about Earth's magnetic field here, we know well that in case of Earth's magnetic field, if we wish to define its vector, we need its magnitude as well as direction. And on the horizontal plane anywhere, if this is Earth's magnetic field, then this has one horizontal component called BH, one vertical component that is BV, and this angle of dip we call theta D. And this theta D is specifying the inclination of Earth's magnetic field with respect to horizontal. Along with this, there is one more angle which is important to be classified, that is, if this actual north-south direction, then this is what we define as delta small d or theta small d, which is the declination angle. Declination angle is the angle which is between the horizontal component of Earth's magnetic field and the actual north-south direction. This actual NS direction, geographical direction on Earth's surface at any point. So this is the direction in which actually the horizontal component exists, and from this horizontal component in its vertical plane at an angle theta D, which we call as dip angle, the actual Earth's magnetic field exists. And we know in southern hemisphere field comes out, and in northern hemisphere of Earth it goes down. So here the magnitude and direction of Earth's magnetic field vector is specified by the quantities. Number one is declination angle. Number two is dip angle. These two angles are required to get the exact direction of Earth's magnetic field. And the third is horizontal component of Earth's magnetic field, because horizontal component of Earth's magnetic field can be calculated by experimental values. And if we know the Earth's horizontal component of field and dip angle, we can calculate the vertical component as well as the net magnetic field of Earth. And these three quantities are cumulatively named as magnetic elements of Earth. So you must keep in mind also, what do we mean by magnetic elements of Earth? There are three magnetic elements which specify the magnetic field vector in space or at any point on the surface of Earth. This is the way how we define the magnetic field vector. If we come to part B of this exercise, where it is asking the angle of dip at a location in southern India is about 18 degrees. What would you expect a greater or a smaller dip angle in Britain? So here we can directly write as Britain is close to North Pole. Obviously, what will happen in this situation, as it is close to North Pole, the angle of dip will be more, because in India or in southern India, as it is 18 degree, which is close to equator compared to Britain, here the angle of dip will be less, because we know close to equator angle of dip is less and close to poles angle of dip is always more. So we can say as Britain is close to North Pole, the angle of dip will be more than 18 degree, or anywhere compared to any place in India or any location in India. So that you need to keep in mind. If we talk about part C, where it is saying, if you made a map of magnetic field lines at Melbourne in Australia, would the lines seem to go into the ground or come out of the ground? Then here we can see, in case of Earth, if this is the northern hemisphere and this is the southern hemisphere of Earth, we know well, close to geographic south pole of Earth there is magnetic north pole, and close to geographic north pole of Earth there is a magnetic south pole, that we already studied in theory lectures. So magnetic lines come out from the south pole, and these lines finally terminate close to north pole. So what happens in southern hemisphere of Earth, magnetic lines are originating, and in northern hemisphere of Earth, magnetic lines are terminating. If we talk about Melbourne in Australia, it exists in southern hemisphere of Earth somewhere here. So in case of Australia, we can write as Australia is located in southern hemisphere of Earth, magnetic lines here will come out of the ground. So the logic is quite clear. Because of magnetic north pole close to the geographic south pole, magnetic lines are coming out, that we also discussed in theory lectures. If we talk about part D of this exercise, here it is asking, in which direction would a compass free to move in the vertical plane point to if located right on the geomagnetic north or south pole? Then here we can say, at north or south poles, Earth's magnetic field is in vertically upward or downward direction. Here we have just now discussed, in case of south pole it is in upward direction, in case of north pole it is in downward direction. This implies a horizontal or a horizontally placed compass may rotate freely and point in any direction, because the magnetic field is in vertically upward or in vertically downward direction. Here if we place a compass needle, where needle is horizontal, the needle will not experience any horizontal torque in this case as well as in this case. So it can point in any direction, because the magnetic field is not applying any torque on the needle. So we cannot specify the direction in which it will be pointing out. For the next part of this exercise, where it is saying, in the Earth's field, it is claimed roughly approximates the field due to a dipole of magnetic moment 8 into 10 to power 22 joule per tesla located at its center. We are required to check the order of magnitude of this number in some way. So here for the Earth, which we know it is of radius 6400 kilometer. This is a standard fact, all of you are aware. And say we place a dipole at the center of Earth, of which the magnetic moment is given by this value 8 into 10 to power 22 joule per tesla. Then due to this magnetic dipole, if we calculate the magnetic field at point P, at point P on Earth's surface, Magnetic induction is given by the axial magnetic field due to a dipole, and the expression we know it is given by mu naught upon 4 pi m by d cube. This is the expression we use. So at point P on Earth's surface, B vector magnitude due to the dipole is this 2 m by d cube, and on equatorial line we can calculate it as mu naught by 4 pi m by d cube. So if we calculate the numerical value at this point, here it is given as 10 to power minus 7 multiplied by twice of m is 8 into 10 to power 22 divided by d cube, and d will be taken here as the radius of Earth. So it is 6.4 into 10 to power 6 whole cube. Numerically, when you calculate, this comes out to be 0.62 Gauss. In Tesla, if you calculate, multiply it with 10 to power minus 4 Tesla. And on equator, if we calculate at point Q, then this was B at P, B at Q is given as mu naught upon 4 pi multiplied by m by d cube. So the factor of half is there. This is approximately 0.31 Gauss. So these are the approximate values due to the dipole we are calculating on the surface of Earth. And the order is same, which is that of the Earth's magnetic field. So this is closely in accordance with the actual values. If we talk about the last part of this exercise, which is saying that the geologists claim that besides the main magnetic north and south poles, there are several local poles on the Earth's surface oriented in different directions. We need to explain how is such a thing possible at all. So here we can say, due to polarization or magnetic polarization of minerals in Earth, several local dipoles are induced, due to which localized NS poles exist on Earth's surface randomly. And we can also say, due to random distribution, effectively, all these gets cancelled out. So we can say effectively all these gets cancelled out. This implies net effect will remain almost same everywhere. So that you need to keep in mind. In this exercise, we have to answer some theoretical questions which are based on some facts also, and some interesting facts related to Earth's magnetism. Let's take up these six parts of the exercise one by one. In part A, we are required to analyze the Earth magnetic field varies from point to point in a space. It is asking, does it also change with time? If so, on what time scale does it change appreciably? Here we can write, and all the answers to these six parts of the exercise are based on some facts. So you must keep in mind, over about 1,000 years of time, Earth's magnetic field changes, and changes also occur periodically, as well as random. Here, when we talk about periodical changes, this may be change in direction of Earth's magnetic field, as well as it may be change in magnitude. And periodical changes may result because of the geological reasons and the reasons inside the core of Earth due to which Earth's magnetism is produced. And random changes are due to magnetic storms and some sudden changes inside the core of Earth. Here we are discussing broadly what's happening over here. If we talk about significant changes, the periodic changes are continuously happening, and to see the significant changes, we can say significant changes can be seen over about 100 years of duration. That means if over a period of 1000 years, if something is periodically changing and it is changing continuously, that means over a period of approximately 10% of duration, we can see the significant change. And after 1000 years, again the state comes to the initial state. So those periodic changes are observed in different situations, and random changes also occur due to magnetic storms or some changes inside the core of Earth due to which Earth magnetism exists. Now let's move on to the second part of this exercise, which is saying the Earth's core is known to contain iron, yet geologists do not regard this as a source of Earth's magnetism. Why? The reason is quite obvious, that iron is a ferromagnetic material, but in molten state it does not show ferromagnetic character. And that's the main reason, because you can see ferromagnetic material after magnetization can behave like a magnet and produce magnetism, but in molten state this iron does not show ferromagnetic character. This implies inside core of Earth due to very high temperature, iron is in molten state and it cannot be the source of Earth's magnetic field, because Earth's magnetic field, if it is due to a magnet, then it must have some ferromagnetic character or some circulating charge particles due to which it is there. So the character of iron is not the reason behind this. That's the reason why it is not considered as the source of Earth's magnetism. If we talk about the part C, where it is saying the charge currents in the outer conducting regions of Earth's core are thought to be responsible for Earth's magnetism, what might be the battery that is a source of energy to sustain these currents? So we know well, inside the core of Earth, the charge particles are circulating on the outer conducting regions of the core. So if this is the core of Earth, here the charge particles are circulating, and due to their circulation they produce magnetic field, and this coil behaves like a magnetic dipole, and which is producing the Earth's magnetic field in the surrounding region in this fashion. So here we can say the charged particles which are gaining energy because of this inner region only. So we can say the source of energy for circulation of charged particles, which are generally ions inside the core of Earth. Maybe the nuclear reactions inside the core due to very high temperature. Due to very high temperature, fusion reaction may take place, and some heavy elements may have a radioactive character also. Because of all such nuclear reaction, the energy is produced, which is supplying energy for circulation of these charged particles. If we move on to part D, where it is saying the Earth may have been reversed the direction of its field several times during its history of 4 to 5 billion years. Now we have to answer, how can geologists know about the Earth's field in such a distant past? So here we can say, in old rocks, based on some radioactive phenomena, and their magnetization, which is found very weak. And magnetization can be very weak only when, if material is magnetized, then it is subjected to opposite direction magnetic field, then only the magnetization goes down. And their magnetization, which is found very weak, experimentally gives the idea about distant past. So lot of analysis based on past centuries and decades is analyzed with the help of some radioactive phenomena, as well as the magnetization which is found in such substances. If we further proceed to part E of this exercise, where it is saying the Earth's field depart from its dipole shape substantially at large distances, which is at a height about 30,000 kilometer. What agencies may be responsible for this distortion? So here we can say, due to currents in outer core of Earth, it behaves like a dipole, which produces Earth's magnetic field. We already discussed Earth's magnetic field is due to circulation of charged particles inside the core of Earth, which are called currents in outer core of Earth. But in outer atmosphere of Earth, due to ionized gases and their movement, the magnetic field gets modified. Because we know in ionosphere of Earth's atmosphere, there are ionized charged particles, which are also in some specific fashion movement, and they also produce their own magnetic field. So in outer atmosphere of Earth, the magnetic field is due to the currents in the core of Earth, as well as due to the ionized charged particle in the ionosphere. So it modifies the overall magnetic field in the surrounding of Earth. So it gets modified, that's why it deviates from the orientation of magnetic field due to the dipole only, which is considered because of the currents in outer core of Earth. So you must be careful about this. And the last part here we are given that if interstellar space has an extremely weak magnetic field of the order of 10 to power minus 12 Tesla, we have to answer, can such a weak field be of any significant consequence? Here we know well that when a charged particle enters in a magnetic field, it moves in a curved path in a circular or curved path. Circular path is taken when it enters in the direction normal to the field, and otherwise it will follow helical path or curved path, in which a radius of motion, if we talk about circular, is given as, this we have studied, the magnetic force QEB provides the necessary centripetal force mv square by r, which gives the value of r as mv over QB. Here we can see as B is very low, this implies r will be very high. That means the particle will move in such a curved path. If a particle is entering in this direction with the velocity v vector and it is deviating, then this deviation will have a very large radius of curvature if b is very low. So we can say here, if this having a radius of curvature r, we can say in interstellar space, the bending in path of charged particles will be very less, because the value of B is very low. That means the deviation will be very, very low because the radius of curvature will be very high. That's the only significance, that if a charged particle is moving due to low magnetic field, the path will be very less deviated. That's only significance in interstellar space for such a low magnetic field. In this exercise, we are given that a short bar magnet placed with its axis at 30 degree with the uniform external magnetic field of 0.25 Tesla. Experiences a torque of magnitude 4.5 into 10 to the power minus 2 joule. We are required to find what is the magnitude of magnetic moment of the magnet. Let's first visualize the situation where if we consider a uniform magnetic field exists from left to right, and this B of which the magnitude is given as 0.25 Tesla. Here we have placed a short bar magnet, which is placed at an angle 30 degree with the uniform external magnetic field, and this is the direction of its magnetic movement. So magnetic movement exists in direction from its south pole to north pole, and say if this is the direction of B vector and its magnetic moment is taken as M vector, and we know well that in uniform magnetic field, torque on a bar magnet is given as, this we already studied, the torque is given as M cross B. So the magnitude of torque will be MB sine theta. And if we substitute the value, then we can see the value of torque is given as 4.5 into 10 to the power minus 2. Magnetic moment we take as M, which we are required to calculate. The magnetic induction is 0.25, and sine 30 degree we take as 0.5, So this giving us the value of magnetic moment of this magnet, which is 4.5 into 10 to the power minus 2 divided by 0.25 into 0.5, which is giving us a numerical value of 0.36 ampere meter square. That is the result of this problem. In this exercise, we are given that a short bar magnet of magnetic moment 0.32 joule per tesla is placed in a uniform magnetic field of 0.15 tesla. It is saying if the bar is free to rotate in the plane of field, which orientation would correspond to its stable and unstable equilibrium, and also we are required to find the potential energy of magnet in each case. And if you can recall, I've already explained you the whole analysis of a stable and unstable equilibrium of a small magnet or a coil or a dipole moment when placed in magnetic field. So we know stable equilibrium corresponds to minimum potential energy of magnetic moment. And unstable equilibrium corresponds to maximum potential energy of magnetic moment. And we know the potential energy of a magnetic dipole, or we consider magnetic moment in uniform magnetic field, is given as, I hope all of you can recall that magnetic potential energy is given as minus m dot b, which is equals to minus mb cos theta. This is the expression we use for potential energy. So here we can see that potential energy is minimum. We talk about part A for a stable equilibrium as the potential energy to be minimum. So this minimum when in this situation theta is equals to 0 degree or cos theta is equals to plus 1. This implies the minimum potential energy for the case of stable equilibrium will be minus m dot b, or it is minus mb cos 0 will be equals to minus mb. If we substitute the value of magnetic moment is 0.32 multiplied by 0.15 tesla. So the numerical value is minus 4.8 into 10 to the power minus 2 joule. This is one result of the problem, and the angle would be 0 degree. So we are also required to find the orientation corresponds to a stable equilibrium. So for this, theta should be 0 degree is the one answer. And the potential energy in this case would be given by minus 4.8 into 10 to the power minus 2 joule. If part B we talk, the orientation and energy corresponds to unstable equilibrium, then we can say here potential energy is maximum when theta is equals to 180 degree. Well, when theta is 180, here cos theta will become minus 1. And when cos theta is minus 1, the potential energy will be maximum, and is minus mb cos of 180 degree. This corresponds to minus mb multiplied by minus 1, that is mb. And on substituting the numerical values, it will be same as 4.8 into 10 to the power minus 2 joule. That's another result of the problem. And for unstable equilibrium, the orientation is 180 degree. That's the result for the orientation of this magnetic dipole, which is placed opposite to the direction of magnetic field. In this exercise, we are given that a closely wound solenoid of 800 tons and area of cross-section 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 4 meters square carries a current of 3 ampere. We are required to explain the sense in which the solenoid acts like a bar magnet. And we are also required to find the associated magnetic moment. So here if we try to visualize a solenoid having total turns 800, area of cross section 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 4 meters square and carrying a current of 3 ampere. Here we can consider this the core of solenoid, on which if we consider closed pack winding like this, and if this is the solenoid and if it carries a current I, depending on the direction sense of the current, say if we consider current is flowing like this, then it produces magnetic field in this direction. So for the solenoid, the magnetic line of forces will originate from this end and circulate like this, and on the other end magnetic lines will be getting into it, and this is the way how magnetic lines behave. So coming out from this end, going into this end, so this terminal behaves like a south pole, this terminal behaves like a north pole, and inside the closed looping of lines are taking place. So inside magnetic field will be from south to north, that's the direction of magnetic moment vector of the solenoid, and this is the way how it is behaving like a bar magnet. If we calculate the magnetic moment of solenoid, then the magnetic moment is given as total number of turns multiplied by current and the enclosed area. That is the way how we write the magnetic moment of the solenoid. And vectorially it is in the direction of area vector given by the direction of magnetic field. So we substitute the numerical values, number of turns are 800, current is 3 ampere, area is 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 4. So numerically the value we are getting is 0.6 joule per tesla, or we can write it ampere meter square. That's the magnetic moment of this coil along the axis of solenoid. That's the direction of this magnetic induction. That's the result of this problem. In this exercise, we are given that if the solenoid in previous exercise is free to turn about the vertical direction and a uniform horizontal magnetic field of 0.25 tesla is applied onto it, we are required to find the magnitude of torque on solenoid when its axis makes an angle 30 degree with the direction of applied field. Here, if we visualize the situation, let's consider there is a horizontal magnetic field and the magnitude of field is given to us as 0.25 tesla. And here, if we place the previous solenoid like this, of which the axis is making an angle 30 degree with the direction of magnetic field, and here if its magnetic moment is along the axis, this is the direction of M vector which we have calculated in previous exercise. Over here you can see I have calculated the value of M as magnetic moment of a solenoid. We have calculated as 0.6 ampere meter square. Magnetic field is 0.25 tesla, and we can directly write the torque on solenoid is given as, vectorially it is written as M cross B, and numerically the value will be MB sine theta. So we substitute the numerical values, M is 0.6, B is 0.25 multiplied by sine theta is given to us as 30 degree, which can be taken as 0.5, that is 0.6 into 0.25 into 0.5, which is resulting the value 0.075 newton meter. That's the result of this problem, the magnitude of torque on the solenoid.